CM Punk appears at NXT Deadline. Cora Jade returns at NXT Deadline. A major title change takes place at NXT Deadline. And Trent Seven signs with NXT. No, he signs with Impact Wrestling, soon to be known again as TNA Wrestling, of course. Hello, and welcome to the Solo Sunday News here at What Culture Wrestling. Myself, Andrew Pollard, from a very wet, very grey, very miserable Wrexham. But hey, the Reds are going up. Yes, let's get into wrestling news. And CM Punk, the talk of the wrestling world for the last couple of weeks, the talk of Raw, the talk of SmackDown, and now the talk of NXT, because to many people's surprise, the Second City Saint appeared at NXT Deadline last night, opening the show. Well, technically Shawn Michaels opened the show, did the usual, you know, he did his "Are you ready?" to get the crowd hyped for Deadline, and then Cult of Personality hit and CM Punk came out, which was kind of cool. It was very cool. It was a nice little fun segment, to be honest. Now obviously on SmackDown, CM Punk, as part of his promo, said that he owed Shawn Michaels a phone call over the weekend. Then there were teases yesterday throughout the day that CM Punk was in Bridgeport, Connecticut, the location of NXT Deadline, and there we go, he comes out in a Bret Hart hoodie, which is always a nice little nod. Apologizes that he couldn't find his Shawn Michaels merch or something, he said. This was an absolutely nothing segment, but also a really fun segment. The two of them, kind of Michaels and Punk, kind of stumbled through their words a little bit. This didn't seem, there wasn't much planning going into this. But it was fun. It was cool. They had a couple of back and forths where Punk basically just said, "Do you want me to sign for Raw?" The crowd booed. "Do you want me to sign for SmackDown?" The crowd booed. And then they all challenged for NXT with the hint in the teasing that CM Punk will sign with NXT, which is never going to happen. There's more chance of me signing with NXT. And over the weekend, I pulled a hamstring going bowling, so that's about as fit and healthy as I am right now, so that's not gonna happen. But yes, CM Punk teased signing with NXT. We all know he's going to Raw. We all know he's going to Raw. But that promo actually on Friday, just how to tick a load of boxes in one go. It's setting up, like, literally in one promo, CM Punk set up feuds with Cody Rhodes, with Roman Reigns, with Kevin Owens, with Randy Orton, anybody and everybody of note that he just went through, obviously with Seth Rollins as well. It was great. It was fun. Jimmy Uso, Jey Uso, Solo Sikoa, just CM Punk, all those people that were kind of from his first promo back on Raw, where it's like, PG Punk, that's a bit safe. Yeah, Friday was good. Friday was fun times, as was NXT Deadline as a whole, to be honest. I enjoyed the show. I feel absolutely knackered today because I've been up, don't know, normally on these Sundays, getting up early and watching wrestling, I still feel normally quite awake, especially after coffee. But today, for some reason, yeah, but that's not an indication of NXT Deadline, because I thought it was a really, really, really good show. And as part of that show was the return of Cora Jade. Yes, now Cora Jade has not wrestled since July. That was a kendo stick match where she lost to Dana Brooke. So she's been away from NXT for that whole period. She returned after the Women's Iron Survivor match, which was won by Blair Davenport. And Blair Davenport was kind of doing the, you know, in the ring, calling out the champion, which is Lyra Valkyria, who came out on the entranceway, did the whole "here's my title," blah, 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 blah. Because, of course, the Iron Survivor winner gets a title shot in the future. And then while Lyra was celebrating, holding her title, kind of jawing off to Blair Davenport, that's where Cora Jade came out, laid out Lyra Valkyria, held the title up herself with the implication that she will be going for that belt herself. Now, it's a strange one with Cora Jade, because you look at it and she is kind of, effectively, she's ready for the main roster. The one thing she has not done, though, is win the NXT Women's Championship. And if she is to stay in NXT for a bit longer, it's not the end of the world. Many were thinking that her absence from TV, when she comes back, it'll be on Raw or SmackDown. But she's still only 22 years of age, which is absolutely crazy. But yes, so she will be in NXT for the foreseeable future, seemingly going after the NXT Women's title. And then, who knows, maybe when the next draft comes around, it is main roster time for Cora Jade. And if you haven't seen it as well, there's a really, really cool video that WWE Digital put out of Cora Jade and CM Punk backstage at Deadline. Now, if you're not aware, Cora Jade is a huge CM Punk fan. There's videos that have been doing the rounds for a couple of years now of her meeting CM Punk at a sign-in, where she's very emotional as a young girl, very emotional, crying. CM Punk's a hero. Her dad's with her, and he kind of commends CM Punk for being such a great role model, being straight edge, and how it's helping Cora Jade at school. Then there's other videos where Cora Jade pops up at a UFC event to ask a question from the crowd to CM Punk. This girl is a massive CM Punk fan, and so there's a backstage promo that she's cutting, well, an interview she's doing, which gets interrupted by CM Punk And it's just, it's cool. It's very wholesome content for a Sunday where it's like, ah, that's, even though she's a heel and she's still playing a heel in this interview, it's like, yeah, she gets a big hug off CM Punk. He brings it in, says how proud he is of her and how she should be proud of herself, how April, as in AJ Lee, is proud of her. And yeah, how NXT is her house. And she is clearly emotional, but then she kind of snaps, literally just snaps back into like heel mode, does a little hand jazzy gesture and like, well, you know, if I've got the approval of CM Punk, that's all that matters. And then kind of brings lots of sass and storms out. And it's great. It's really cool. If you haven't seen it, go out of you to find that on X, as it is these days. The former, the artist formerly known as Twitter. Right. Other NXT deadline news. There was a major title change because we have a new NXT North American champion. Yes, Dragon Lee defeated Dominic Mysterio. Dirty Dom is the North American champion no more. Yes, this was, again, a really fun match. It was, that's the kind of the word of the day for NXT deadline. It's fun. It was a really fun wrestling show, I thought, from start to finish, from top to bottom. But yes, Dragon Lee defeated Dominic Mysterio. Of course, Dragon Lee being a late replacement for Wesley, who on Tuesday announced that, unfortunately, he has to undergo back surgery that's going to leave him on the shelf for between 8 to 12 months. So best wishes to Wesley on all of that. But yeah, Dragon Lee stepped in, defeated Dominic Mysterio. I was going to say Rey Mysterio then. Rey Mysterio was on commentary, cheering on Dragon Lee against his own son, of course, Dirty Dominic. And yeah, Dragon Lee as well, he won with the Acai DDT, and then got to celebrate with Rey Mysterio afterwards outside the ring. They had an embrace with the title, which again was just a really cool moment because for Dragon Lee, Rey Mysterio is a genuine legend here. I mean, he's a legend to everybody, but he was his idol growing up, his hero growing up, his role model growing up. So it was cool. It was cool to see. And it was a really fun match. It was like, what, about 10 minutes? I think it was just over 10 minutes. But Dragon Lee brings an end to Dominic Mysterio's second reign as North American champion. And then that brings with it, of course, questions as to the repercussions of this with Dirty Dom, with Judgment Day and with Mami, because Mami's not going to be best pleased when we come to Raw on Monday night. And this could be, again, just another fun cog to put at play in the Judgment Day, because you've got Damian Priest kind of stepping up to be the leader. Rhea Ripley is essentially the de facto leader, though. There's a little bit of dissension there in the ranks of Judgment Day. And it's an ever-developing situation. So this is another little layer to throw into that now Dominic doesn't have gold. Of course, Finn Balor and Damian Priest do have gold. Rhea Ripley does have gold. And JD McDonagh's there. JD's good. I'm a fan of JD, so I'm not going to knock it too much. Right, one last news story before we get to your questions. And it doesn't involve NXT or WWE or AEW. It is TNA Wrestling, well, soon to be TNA Wrestling, currently still Impact Wrestling. They have signed Trent Seven. Yes, the Mustache Mountain Man. Now, he turned up last night at Impact's Final Resolution show, being the mystery partner of Speedball Mike Daly? God, this is this early morning. Speedball Mike Bailey, one of the greatest wrestlers on the planet. Against the Rascals. Now, it was after the match, which, of course, Trent Seven and Speedball Mike Daly won. Then Scott D'Amore came out, cut a promo basically praising Trent Seven, saying that he's essentially had his eye on him for a while, has wanted to sign him for a while, but he couldn't because he was at another place, as in WWE, and then some idiots at the other place released Trent Seven, and now he has the opportunity to sign him. And then Trent signed a contract there and then on the back of Speedball Mike Bailey, to be precise, which is a nice little play on when Speedball signed with Impact, which he signed his contract on the back of Josh Alexander. So yeah, Trent Seven is in the Impact zone, or the TNA zone, or he's in that promotion, the Anthem promotion, which is in that weird place now where we still refer to it as Impact Wrestling because it is Impact Wrestling, but then also the branding on it, like the announcement for it is Trent Seven signs with, because they did the official graphic, like AEW does the hashtag All Elite. So it's Trent Seven has signed with TNA Wrestling. It's like, well, you're technically still Impact for now because the rebranding kicks in with Hard to Kill next month in January. I think it's January the 13th or 14th, whatever weekend that is. That's when Hard to Kill is, and that's when the rebrand or the re-rebrand to TNA kicks in. But either way, I'm always happy to talk about TNA Wrestling or about Impact Wrestling because it's a really cool promotion to keep an eye on. I know people don't really watch it that much in terms of more mainstream coverage. I mean, it's not the easiest of shows to find or track down, but those who watch Impact, there's so much great wrestling there. There's so many great talents there. I mean, you just, the roster is absolutely stacked. I mean, talk about Mike Bailey. He genuinely is in that conversation for best wrestler in the world right now. Josh Alexander is another one. I mentioned him. And then you've got people like Dele Perazzo. You've got the Trinity, Mickey J. There's just the roster there. Obviously, of course, Alex Shelley. The Motor City Machine Guns, period. Alex Shelley and Chris Sabin, Moose. There's a lot of good going on in Impact Wrestling. So go and give it some love if you haven't for a while. It's definitely worth the hunting down. Right, let's get to some questions and then we can get this wrapped up and I can go and watch AEW Collision and write some ups and downs. Right, Hector Garcia III has got in touch. Hello, Hector. Happy Solo Sunday, assuming you are not off. No, I am very much here today and next Sunday, and then I am off. Assuming Cody finishes the story at WrestleMania, do we assume that he will... There's a lot of assumings here. Do we assume that he will only start carrying around the newest singular belt that Roman was given and will no longer see the additional two belts that Paul Heyman carries? Yes, 1,000% yes. It will make no sense whatsoever for Cody to beat Roman and to then basically carry three belts around, and it would be nice just to just to have that one title, because that's the one title that means everything in terms of that brand, in terms of SmackDown. The other two are essentially historical pieces by this point in time. So yes, I think Cody, if and when he finishes his story, then he will just have the one singular title. So thanks for that question, Hector. Where are we? Mitchell Gillum's got in touch. Hey, Mitchell. Just a fun thought I had. Austin Theory is this generation's Maven. Can you see the resemblance? I absolutely cannot. No. I don't know if you mean like in terms of physically, I can't see any resemblance really, and in terms of working style, I can't see any resemblance, and in terms of potential, should we say, Maven's underrated. Maven was there's a lot of talent in that dude. Had a really sweet drop kick. There was a lot there. It wasn't just a case of like, oh, he's one of the reality shows, we have to have him on TV. It's like, no, there's a good base there in Maven. But Austin Theory, I mean, we're talking somebody there who very much legitimately has that WrestleMania main event potential. Love him or hate him, there's a lot of people that don't like him, but in terms of talent, there's a lot to work with there. The Grant Perkins has got in touch. Go and give Grant a follow. He's a lovely fella. Does some amazing artwork. A lot of it's wrestling related. Go and check him out on Twitter. There's a little free property there, Clug. Grant. Right. Why are you so unnecessarily tall? I am not unnecessarily tall. I'm about 6'1", maybe 6'2". It's not like scary, scary tall. Mark Jackson's got in touch. Up by Easter? Yes, Wrexham will be up by Easter. Right, wrestling questions. Jeff, formerly Paradigm. Hope you're having a good day, fella. I wanted to get this in early. Here's a fun one for you. What's more iconic, Roderick Strong's Adam or Matt Riddle's Randy? I would go with Matt Riddle's Randy, although both kind of grind my gears a bit, especially the Adam stuff. That's got old on me really quick. It was fun the first few times. I sound like the old man screaming at the cloud sort of thing. The first few times it was funny. After that, it's like, okay, we need to do a bit more than just scream Adam. This is Roderick Strong, who is an exceptional professional wrestler. Let's do more with him than just have him roll around screaming Adam or Samoa or Dasha or whatever else he was screaming last week. Yeah, so for me, by default, I think Matt Riddle's Randy gets the nod there. David Eric, the 1Ks. I think that's what that says. Good morning. It's Adam, destined to become the new what? There's a lot of Adam here. And do you think that's a good or bad thing? Personally, I'm enjoying everything Roddy Strong is doing right now. Have a great Sunday. You have a great Sunday too, David. I don't believe it's going to be the new what. I think that if anything's going to be the new what right now, it's going to be, I was going to say Eli Drake. Man, that's a blast from the past. It's going to be LA Knights. That'll be the new what if there is one. I hope there's no more new whats. I hope there's no nothing like that, because it's just, yeah. For all the great things Steve Austin did for the wrestling business, for all the positives he brought to it. And this is as somebody who was a Stunning Steve fan. Well, I wasn't a Stunning Steve fan back then at the time. I hated him because he was a heel and I was a child. But this is somebody who kept an eye on Austin since his Stunning Steve Austin days in WCW. So for all the greatness he's done, is that WCW run as a singles, as a tag with Brian Pillman, the Hollywood Blondes, his time in ECW, his when he finally got going in WWF, when the Ringmaster was dropped, Ted DiBiase was put to one side, the rivalries with Bret Hart, and then, you know, WrestleMania 14 beating Shawn Michaels, the rivalry with The Rock, with Vince McMahon, all of that, all that Austin did, the comeback against Kevin Owens. The one massive negative he left on this business is that darn what chant. So I hope that Adam does not become the new what. I hope that nothing becomes the new what. Where have we got any more questions? Oh, the Tribal Fiends got in touch. Money Legend, not so much of a question in the normal sense, but what are your thoughts on this fantasy booking for WrestleMania 40? Right, let's have a look at this. So we've got Cody Rhodes versus Roman Reigns, Hell in a Cell match for the Undisputed Championship. Seth Rollins versus Gunther, Last Man Standing match for the World Heavyweight Championship. Got CM Punk versus Stone Cold Steve Austin. Rhea Ripley versus Shayna Baszler for the Women's World Heavyweight Championship. Asuka, Io Sky, Kairi Sane, and Dakota Kai versus the Four Horsewomen, an eight-woman elimination tag. Bianca Belair versus Jade Cargill for the Women's Championship. Logan Paul versus LA Knight for the United States Championship. Drew McIntyre versus Sheamus versus Chad Gable for the IC title. DIY versus Creed Brothers versus New Day versus Judgment Day in a TLC match for the tag titles. Jimmy Uso versus Jey Uso in an Unsanctioned match. Randy Orton versus John Cena in an I Quit match where John Cena retires. Rey Mysterio versus Dirty Dom in a ladder match for the Career versus North American Championship. And Bron Breakker versus Brock Lesnar. That is a very, very imaginative card you've got there, Tribal Fiend. I think for me, it's a smidge too gimmicky. So we've got one Hell in a Cell match. We've got a Last Man Standing match. We got then technically an elimination tag match, a TLC match, an unsanctioned match, an I Quit match, and a ladder match. So we got seven gimmick matches on a card. I think that's a bit much for me. I'm afraid there's some good matches there. There's some matches there I think will happen. I think Rhea Ripley versus Shayna Baszler. I love Shayna Baszler, but I think right now that seems completely unimaginable for a WrestleMania stage. I think we get Becky Lynch versus Rhea Ripley myself. Where else are we? Jade Cargill, I don't think she'll be on the WrestleMania card. I don't think she'll be deemed ready by then. I fully expect to see her in the Royal Rumble, but then I think she'll be in NXT for a little while. Jimmy Uso versus Jey Uso, yeah, I can see that totally. Rey versus Dom, I can see that, although obviously not the North American title being on the line. There's a lot here. CM Punk versus Stone Cold Steve Austin. If they can make that happen, they will make that happen. But I think we will get Rollins versus Punk. Although originally, before CM Punk returned, I was pulling for Seth Rollins versus Gunther. So yeah, we got a good card there. There's a good card coming together there. A little smidge too gimmicky for me, but I like your thoughts there. Right, and with that, that is the Solo Sunday News done for another week. Yes, I am off to write AEW Collisions Up and Down. Simon Miller will be with the Ups and Downs video for that tomorrow. There are other AEW Ups and Downs and SmackDown Ups and Downs and joyous things on this channel right now. So go and check them out. I'm going to go and do that stuff. I'm Andrew Pollard here at What Culture Wrestling. Have a good one. I believe it's Wilbon and Murray back tomorrow. And I'll catch you next weekend.